Second is to suggest whether this is the sort of work, the range of work, which you should continue forever and a day. But as it's a founder's lecture, I obviously come here also to praise your founder, Sir George Williams. Reading about him, for I have to confess, I wasn't as up-to-date as perhaps I should have been, I learned that when he died, he was buried in the funeral was in St Pauls. Also reworking the monies he left then in today's terms, he left the equivalent of £26 million. And he made that by trade, not by speculation, not by taking over companies and ripping the heart out of them and selling them on with the debt that he had made, but by honestly doing a day's work himself, encouraging his employees to do so, and was well rewarded. But that itself, of course, is not the main aspect of why there's a Founders' Day lecture. He did, amongst many other things, help form with a very small group of people, but he was the guy who then drove the idea through. He formed the YMCA in 1844, and this became what one observer said was the labour exchange of the empire. It did more than actually put people in touch with one another. It not only developed ideas, it built an international community. So part of tonight's lecture is to praise those who are actively involved in the YMCA effort. And indeed, it's a rather delightful thing and shows the originality of their thought and their ability to rethink where power is and how power might be exercised and influenced, this initiative of having parliamentary patrons. It's such a good idea, I can assure you, that many other voluntary groups will now be copying what you've done. But you've got in first and you've probably got more MPs than any other group will manage to harvest. But in the work that YMCA does, you've got a presence in 125 countries, and last year you reached 45 million people. It's always surprising, isn't it, when politicians talk about the big society without always recognising the big societies in front of them. I would hope, given the basis of your work, you are much courted under this initiative. For while, of course, you have that global reach, most people are put off by the idea of a big society. Very few people want to escape from the big state into the big society. Most people appreciate little societies. And of course, what you do here, and what I know about in this country, is you have that personal presence. And while you may, for example, and indeed do have presences, buildings, activities in 135 of our constituencies. To our constituents, they won't think of you in those terms. They think of you as the friendly face that actually helps them. And I want to then divide the two rates of activities that you undertake to pose the basic question for tonight's address. Amongst the information you proudly publish, you will rightly say that tonight over 7,000 people will lodge with you. It will be a roof over their head. You have policies, I heard as I came in, about helping to promote positive family relationships. You are the largest voluntary sector in providing physical activities and such activities. But I want to question two other of your activities, not because I don't think you should be doing them, but to question what else does it tell us about our society. There's two in particular. One is, under your programme of giving young people a fresh start, you say, this includes vocation and informal school and work-based learning opportunities which enable young people to gain the necessary skills to get a job and enter the workplace. In another place you talk of in last year, 2010, you delivered a range of apprenticeships and advanced apprenticeships to almost 2,500 young people, but you go on to say, nobody would think we can get too many apprenticeships, but 3,500 young people aged between 14 and 19 benefited from your foundation programmes and specialist projects designed to re-engage young people in learning. So it's the re-engaging young people in learning and giving people a fresh start to get them ready for the labour market I want to raise as our questions tonight. Because though I applaud you doing it, I want to ask, is it satisfactory that we rely on the voluntary arm to do that, particularly as all those young people will have been given 13 years of public investment in them, from their early years through to when they technically leave school? We all know, of course, that some of them do not actually last the full course of leaving school at 16. But even so, there'd be 13 years of investment, averaging out about £6,000 to £7,000 a year. So taxpayers put a large, large sum of money behind each of us when we're young going through our school system. And yet, if we look at the qualifications or the lack of qualifications for last year, we find that 4,800 pupils were entered for their GCSEs. We've got no qualifications whatsoever. And well over 17,000 other young people were not even entered for those examinations. Now, of course, you might say that some of these young people are themselves facing huge difficulties and would have special learning difficulties. And yet, of course, the figures don't support that. Because if we look at those who are in special schools, who will be there, amongst those will be those of our constituents who have the most severe learning difficulties that any of us face, we now find these schools, which have been cut down in size, and therefore we know that they're taking people only with the most severe learning difficulties, are themselves beginning to chalk up GCSE examination successes for their constituents. And therefore the question I pose, what is it that's going on in schools which after 13 years of public education, public investment, we find people without a qualification at all, and others, a larger number, not even entered for those public exams, which leads to the terrific work that you do as the YMCA in those courses of trying to re-engage people, maybe getting them back into schools in the first place, and secondly, getting them to the starting line. And by God, it's not much of a starting line. It's a starting line so that people know it's important to get up in the morning, know it's important to look moderately well-dressed, that they need some social skills if any employer anywhere is in fact going to give them a job. And the difficulties of these young people is brought out now in the two cohort studies that we have of what happens to those who leave at 16 who don't get a job, how long do they last without getting a job, and is their position much improved if they hang on until they're 18? Well, there's no surprises, is there, to be in answering that question. But for those who leave school at 18, although they face difficulties, some of them big difficulties in landing jobs, they land jobs easier than those who left school at 16 or unofficially before 16. For those who leave at 16, we know from the cohort studies, well over a quarter of them are still unemployed at 18. And that at the age of 27, 5% have never, ever, ever had a job, even a temporary job or a Christmas job. And the question, therefore, that I do pose is, what are we doing, what are we getting wrong, which delivers so many of our young people to the labour market, many of them unable to read or write. It's as grim as that in my constituency, and it must be true of other constituencies as well. And I want to suggest to the basis of our discussion tonight is, first of all, we clearly don't organise schools around young people and their needs, and what particular single move might we make which would ensure that more swim and fewer sink? And then, of course, I want to talk something about, if I may, about the foundation years and the, to me, the staggering findings we came up with, which really turn our education system on its head. I asked to, and now do, chair the Academy School in Birkenhead. It's a school that was formed about two, what we have to say in public, are our most challenged schools. You all know perfectly well what I mean by our most challenged school. And the goal is, as whether we can in fact prevent the continuance of this cycle of decline and begin to build real success for not most of those young people, but for every one of those young people who either opt for or who are made to come to our academy. I do not believe we will be able to do that if we have a traditionally managed and run school. But we have coming in next year, we will have a large number of young pupils who will not be anywhere near, or will not have acquired anywhere near, the skills in reading and writing and arithmetic that other 10 to 11 year olds will have. And the question we have to face is, what are we going to do this summer? And also, how are we going to change how we organise our first year to ensure that we don't pretend they're all up to standard, but that our main activity is to make sure that most of them can begin, if not all of them, can begin to fly. For the truth is, in the secondary sector, we like to blame the primary sector. We say if only the primary school sent us pupils up to the grades they should have, life would be so much simpler, and we could get on with the job without trying to rescue them. Although for lots of them, the figures show we don't rescue them. And primary schools rightly say, well, if only parents produce their children on the first day at school in a manner which fitted them to benefit from the wonderful schools that we have, we would be able to educate them rather than be involved in rescue work. And the question that I'm going to pose to you, I think we should end this game of blaming other people. And actually, wherever we are in the education system, try our bit to change it so that all young people fly, but also look at how we perhaps get the totality, the structure of the education system wrong. Which leads me on to what I want to say in link to this about from the Foundation Years Report. I was staggered by two pieces of information that were presented to the inquiry. And by the way, it has reported, it's all over, it's all done with. But it is the best kept secret in Westminster that it's been reported, that it's been accepted, and practically all the recommendations are going to be implemented. I feel a bit like the position that Oscar Wilde was in, saying that he could keep a secret. It's the people he tells them to who come. I keep going around telling people the secret. Not enough of you are spreading it around. It's still a great secret, I fear. I have one or two things planned, of course, to try and actually change that. But the two staggering pieces of information were, first, from one of the cohort studies which we've used to try and plot people's progress from the first week of birth through into adulthood. And reworking this data, the researchers at the Institute of Education in the University of London found that probably at three, but certainly at five, we can predict where young people will be in their early adulthood. We can generally tell who will get the best jobs, who will be in employment, who will be in the skilled trade, who will find it difficult to get into employment, who will be unemployed, indeed, who might well end up in prison. And while, of course, there are noble exceptions to any class analysis, And while maybe practically everybody in this room would have benefited from growing up in a family with a mother with sharp elbows, who ensured that we actually got on and might well have disproved the basis of this generality, sadly the generality holds. So that those primary school teachers who say to me, as children walk through into school on their first day, I can tell who's going to be head girl, who's going to be prefect, who's going to excel, who's going to get the best jobs. The research shows that that innate wisdom that reception class teachers and primary school teachers have is borne out by much more detailed work. And it would suggest, therefore, that the education system that we have, which pays more money to schools and education establishments, the older pupils become, is actually the wrong model. If we really want to make a difference, if we really want to change life chances, then it's during those first early years which are so crucial. And they're not years which we, as the great experts, can manage. They are years which parents are in control. So that if we are going to be successful here, it is through a program which enables parents to succeed, rather than for them to feel that their children are going to fail as they fail. For it's noticeable, one of the research bodies that's based in Birkenhead, which undertook work with 15-year-olds in Great Yarmouth, showed that young people at 15 had very clear visions of what they wanted their own children to do, to achieve. They weren't bizarre, they weren't way out of line, they were noble objectives. Then asked, do you expect your aspirations to be fulfilled? And they said, we don't have expectations that they will be fulfilled. And therefore, clearly one of the great and missing links in this great chain of being is how do we empower parents so that their aspirations keep level with their expectations? Or in other words, how do we rise their expectations so they meet their aspirations? That was one piece of information we had. The other piece of information, which was even more disturbing, was that I asked the head of one of our local schools, and this is not a dummy school at all, it's a school where I first learned over 20 years ago, that parents faced with the ration book economy of the public sector will do anything to get their children into a better school, and therefore lying about your address is one of the smaller things you might be called upon to do. While, of course, lying is wrong, I couldn't but help respect those parents, their energy at making sure their children could have a better start than them. But the head of this school, when I asked him, could you list the 10 qualities you want all children to have on their first day of school? And then would you share that information with your staff and with other schools in the area? Came up with the following results. He said that, and of course not all children in this position, but some were. It would be an advantage for schools if on the first day of arrival, all pupils knew their name. Secondly, they knew how to speak. Thirdly, they could sit still, because without being able to sit still, how do you ever begin a process of learning or build up relationships with your neighbours on the same table? It was important to be able to take basic items of clothing off and put them on again, to be able to pick up a crayon and know the crayon wasn't for stabbing somebody, but was actually for drawing with and maybe the beginnings of writing, to know what a book is about and that maybe there's a thrill in opening the book, even if it's somebody else who actually reads to you. And because the six authorities in Liverpool, following what the government did in setting up the report they asked me to write, set themselves up a Poverty and Life Chances Commission. We tried this out with other schools in other areas of Merseyside, and the findings were not dissimilar of actually wishing young people to have that basic information. And therefore the question one has to pose is, if we are going to change the workload, the priorities that the YMCA has, some of it crucially carried out in trying to make up for those young people who can neither read nor write to get them to a state where they might well be able to find some work and benefit from that and grow from that position, then clearly we need to do something earlier than actually picking people up in ambulances at the end of the line. And what the report proposes on this is, first of all, when pupils in Birkenhead and in Manchester are asked, what do you want most if you were going to design your school contract? What six things do you want out of this school when you leave? They obviously said they wanted to be able to get a job. But they said two other remarkable things, and every one of them in the sample said this. They wanted to know how to make lifelong friendships. They thought that was important to learn at school. And of course, for some of them who have toe rags as parents, it's a total negation of the way they are being brought up. There are many young people in my constituency that if I face the challenges they face, I wonder whether I would actually survive. That's how grim it is for them. But none of them, on the second thing that they said, they wanted to know if schools could teach them how to be good parents. Not better parents, none of them let down their parents by publicly acknowledging that there was a lot to be desired in their own home. They actually all said, every one of them, from good or bad homes, they said they wanted to know how to be good parents. And therefore, one of the things that we have done, and where the government is proving a bit sticky on, is how do we, first of all, develop that culture in primary schools, which is crucial to successful building of lifelong friendships, but also the running of a family later on. How do you build that sense of order and hierarchy, of the necessity of making decisions and of carrying them out, so that young people experience that richly at school? And secondly, how do we continue that in secondary schools, but also provide them with the technical knowledge about being good parents, not in a ghetto subject, which you will send, schools will send all those who are not going to go in for the exams as a suitable case for treatment, but through each of the main parts of the national curriculum. So, for example, in the science module, there we developed the science part of GCSEs, we've developed a module which actually looks at brain development, so that every young person, long before they become parents, begins to get some idea about how crucial the development is in the womb, and those first few days and weeks and months are in ensuring that those necessary connections in the brain are made in a positive rather than a negative way. For the very rich children, when they enter school, will have heard 32 million more words than the poorest pupils entering school. And the 32 million words will mainly be ones about enabling rather than shutting up. Now, again, most young people, when I've tried out the work with them, are both staggered, both also engaged, but also anxious that their children don't actually draw the short straw, as that many of them have done so. And when the question about what their brothers and sisters have had at their prenatal and postnatal classes, how Sure starts to perform, all of them coming with very clear reforms that they would like to see operating in these areas so that they will be much better parents than the parents which they had, even if their parents were good parents. So the question that I pose to the YMCA is, and I salute the work that you do, but if the recommendation, which has been accepted when it's operated, is that the Sure Starts go out to tender, so that they are increasingly run by voluntary bodies, that they are increasingly focused and paid on their outcomes. How many of the most vulnerable parents have you contacted? And how ready is your cohort, your group of pupils, ready for school? somehow that our wage check somehow concentrates the mind wonderfully, like being hung in the morning. And my attempt, certainly, I've always defend short sight in public. But it's been quite hard amongst the councillors in the Merseyside region who've had short starts in their wards, who report back the same that I did experience. They're beginning to change now because they know the writing's on the wall. That in fact, the bushy-tailed mums who were the easiest to deal with, who dominated the proceedings, it makes short start very, very difficult to defend when cuts are on the agenda, when so many of one's own local councillors know precisely what sort of deal has actually been dealt, and that it is surprising that almost no short start can tell you how many of the children in their area do they contact, how many of those are the most vulnerable, and what activities are they undertaking regularly with the most vulnerable to make sure that some of those activities which you do at the end of the day are trying to get people who can neither read nor write ready for the labour market are not always on a supply line coming to you asking for help. So let me conclude by, if I may, briefly summarising what I've been trying to say tonight. It has been one to salute you as one of the great voluntary movements in the free world. And it's again important to remember this began not by some great government initiative, although government initiatives do sometimes start great things, because short start will develop into a great thing, finally. But that was a government initiative. But it was started by a very small group of young people, and then with one amongst their crowd who thought this idea could be a winner of doing precisely that. And it is a terrific thing to behold, marvellous to see the range of your work. But I do question, when we look at the poor performance overall of British schools, that part of the answer to that is that life race, for so many young people, is already over before they cross the school door for the first time. But that once those cross the school door, we're not very good at accepting that we have actually got to make up for what those children do not have. And I think a system that automatically promotes everybody by age discriminates against those who find it most difficult to acquire the skills that which their peers have. And it's all very well to promote jump years for the very bright pupils. It's deadly to leave pupils year after year in a peer group when they are nowhere near the average of their peer group's qualifications. So the plea is for you now, if you ever have time, from attending to the extraordinary record that you have, to also begin to think, what would you do today if you were part of that meeting in that draper's shop in St Pauls Churchyard with George Williams, well before he was knighted? What would you actually pose now as the additional tasks that you should undertake? For I would hope that if we could have a seance, and Sir George was with us tonight, he would actually be saying, of course, we have ambulance work to do, but we also got to make sure that people